Hi, everybody. Rachel O'Brien, Deputy Secretary for Legislative Affairs at the Department of Food and Agriculture. Thank you so much for hanging in there with us. We are having some technical difficulties. We did choose to use GoToMeeting webinar because we could do the registration link, but hindsight's 2020, and we should have just gone with the good old Zoom. With that, you know, I'll just welcome you, to our annual celebration of Healthy Soils Week, which aligns with the UN World Soils Day and includes a week-long calendar of events from December 6th through December 10th. This is hosted by CDFA as well as state, federal, and private sector partners. And I just wanted to read to you a quote from Secretary Ross, where she explained this year's Healthy Soils Week theme, which is solutions from the soil, improving California's drought resiliency, which highlights why it is more important than ever to invest in our soils. Farmers and ranchers are stewards of our soil and are key to solutions to address climate change and achieve carbon neutrality. Implementing healthy soils management practices provides many co-benefits beyond the crops they harvest and the food on our tables. And that's something that we can all appreciate. And with that, I wanted to introduce our moderator, Sharon Nance. Sharon served at USDA and the Natural Resources Conservation Service for 30 years, and she retired last September as the Assistant State Conservationist for Field Operations in our very own Fresno, California. Her experience with USDA and NRCS includes working with the Civil Rights Division, Legislative Affairs Office, Programs, and the Outreach Division. She also assisted the startup of the USDA Office Advocacy and Outreach as the National Program Director. And under the first Vilsack administration, Sharon was USDA's Strike Force Coordinator for 8 Western states. She began her career as a California rural sociologist working with the Central Valley's Southeast Asian fruit and vegetable producers. And the focus of her career has always included assisting all historically underserved stakeholders and helping them navigate and understand and participate in opportunities that are available to them through NRCS's technical and financial assistance. And lastly, Sharon's got amazing credentials on the university front. She has a bachelor's degree in psychology. She earned a master's degree in education, and her PhD is in rural sociology and agricultural economics from Ohio State University. So with that, Sharon, I will turn it over to you.
Thank you, Rachel. May, can you nod to confirm that you can hear me? Excellent, thank you. That is one of the things that we've learned in Zoom land, is that we have to get these affirmations very, very quickly. Good afternoon. You are very, very welcome to this presentation. We have some incredible resources that are very anxious to share with you their understandings of how this thing called soils applies to our lives every single day. I appreciate the opportunity to explore this topic with you this morning, and I'm going to invite you as we go through to put your questions in the chat. We will try to get to those as expeditiously as we can. But more than anything, we're going to ask that you keep an open mind and stay as flexible as possible, because we're working on trying to get this instrument to work for all of us today. It's my privilege, though, to open this webinar with the Sweet Potato Project. Sweet Potato Project 2. It is my understanding that this is an outgrowth from a national program that began in St. Louis. But absolutely, you know, we have to have a California twist to these things. And it's really been my honor to see this program grow over the years and understand the incredible benefits that have come with working with these youth who have worked to try to better understand who they are and who they can be using agriculture as a tool. You know, this is a chance to learn about themselves and to learn about the career opportunities that are associated with agriculture in the 21st century. So with that, I'm going to invite Yolanda, Yolanda Randles, the executive director, to talk more about her project. And Yolanda, I have your slides, so I'm going to open them and ask you to just let me know when you wish to have them advanced.
Okay, great, thank you. Can you all hear me okay? Great. Woo-wee. This is technology, I'm telling you, or something else. Okay, so again, Yolanda Randles, West Fresno Family Resource Center, and I'm not sure, Patrick, if he's on the line, he'll be joining us. West Fresno Family Resource Center, we're a nonprofit community-based organization housed in West Fresno. Our primary goal really is about family strengthening and family improvement. We actually heard about this River Theater project probably about 10 years ago. It was posted in an Aetna like calendar. We read about it and we thought, oh my goodness, we have got to bring this program to Fresno. And so about 5 years ago, there was a funding opportunity with the California Department, California Reducing Disparities Project, and we were able to get funding for this project. The Sweet Potato Project is a prevention program. It's really aimed at reducing like gang involvement, substance abuse initiation, all of those bad elements that are in communities like West Fresno. West Fresno is a low-income minority community, and poverty and all of that surrounds that. You know, so the Sweet Potato Project really is about building hope for the future. So we started we have two phases. Phase one is April through July, right? And so in April, we start with the Sweet Potato Club, the kids meet, we talk about community issues, life issues, what's going on at school. In June is when we start talking about ag. We start talking about the sweet potato. The kids are learning about the sweet potato, the slip, the planting process, the nutritional value, you know, everything you would want to learn about a sweet potato. And then in July, August, the youth actually participate in a five-week business class at Fresno State. And granted, these kids are between the ages of like 10 and 16. And so a lot of these kids have never stepped foot on a college campus. And here they are at Fresno State being taught by an ag professional, by an ag professor, who is teaching them about ag business, entrepreneurship, and ag and career and development. So here's just some pictures in phase one where the kids are meeting at the Maxie Parks Community Center. You can go to the next slide. Again, May is plant day. So after they get all of that information, the kids are actually in the field. We have 2 acres of land where the kids are actually planting sweet potatoes. They're weeding, they're irrigation, they are, and even harvesting. And again, this is phase one, July, August. They're at Fresno State. They also participate in a pitch day. The kids have to come up with a product with the sweet potatoes. They have to create some type of product from the sweet potato. And we have a pitch day competition where the kids are in front of judges and families and friends. So they're learning about all the 7 P's of marketing. They've learned about all of those things. So here, September through December, it's harvest time, right? So the kids are in the field. They are learning how to harvest their sweet potatoes. We have a farm stand. The kids are actually selling their sweet potatoes. We also do another little competition with the kids too to see how much sweet potatoes they can sell. In December is the close of our season, and we have an end of the year celebration. And these are just some actual pictures of our sweet potatoes that the kids have harvested. And again, this is phase two. This is part of our end of the year celebration. That's Mark Salazar. He is our deputy police chief with Fresno Powell. They have been involved with the program from the very beginning. So I'm not sure. Go ahead. I'm not sure if you're able to play that video. Nope. Okay. We'll keep it going. These are some of our partners in the program. Fresno State. Can you go back? Fresno State. We have the African American Farmers, the Central Valley Policy Institute. Our program has been evaluated, and we are now an evidence-based practice We also have USDA as consultants, site preparation, and also ag training. The next slide. Our vision, our hope, our long-term goals, right? So we would love to have an ag training school in our community. The ag industry, with our population of kids, they have no idea the types of careers that are available in ag. And to provide that training right here in our community will be a great opportunity. We would love to have a food truck. All of these great recipes that these kids have created, from sweet potatoes, from sweet potato muffin to sweet potato churro to sweet shakes to sweet potato ice cream, like all of these different recipes that these kids have made. And so our food truck is a long-term goal. And this is a training opportunity. So the kids would get business, culinary, marketing, communication, accounting. All of these skills would be presented, through the food truck. One day we would like to own our own land. You know, right now we are on a demonstration site with the African American farmers. So one day to have land ownership where we have our own land, where we can, sort of come and go as we please and perhaps extend more than 2 acres. Next slide. We had a great opportunity to visit the state capitol. Warren Arambula is our assemblyman. The Sweet Potato Project was acknowledged on the these are pictures of the kids in Sacramento. The video from Juan Arambula, we won't be able to see it today, though, but it is, it'd be great if we can show that. I'm not sure if it'll play or not.
Today, we have the honor of welcoming more than 40 students, parents, and staff from the West Family Resource Center. Also in the gallery is the staff from the California Department of Public Health, the Office of Health Equity. The students visiting here today from West Fresno are participating in the Sweet Potato Project. This program is made possible by the California Reducing Disparities Project, a state-funded 5-year pilot program designed to reduce disparities and to improve the mental health of children in the underserved, disadvantaged communities. The Sweet Potato Project is aimed at preventing and reducing school dropouts and gang involvement and substance abuse initiation among African American youth in West Fresno. Through this effort, the West Fresno Family Resource Center is providing opportunities to increase African American youth engagement in the community, to encourage educational attainment, provide mentorship, and to provide leadership development. Now, in the project's second year, the students are planning, planting, and growing sweet potatoes and developing a sweet potato-based product to take to market, all while taking entrepreneurship classes at the Lyle Center at Fresno State. The West Fresno Family Resource Center has been a successful, positive, growing experience for the students that you see before you here today. These students are obtaining a valuable business experience, practicing teamwork, and gaining confidence in themselves that will inspire them to great heights. I congratulate these students on their hard work and thank them for their participation in the Sweet Potato Project. When I was explaining this project at home this morning to my daughter, she grew excited about the opportunity to come and thank fellow students who come from my community, who give back to my community, and who are planting the seeds that make difference for leadership in my community. If you could help me to welcome the students of the West Fresno Family Resource Center, as well as my daughter, who came up here from Fresno here today, and thank them for their participation in this program.
Yeah, that was a great opportunity for our kids to be there in Sacramento to have that great acknowledgement. The next slide. As I stated earlier, our program was evaluated by the Central Valley Health Policy Institute, and our report is also available on our website. We actually have proven that this is an evidence-based practice that we were able to improve outcomes in our kids. And so if you have questions, here's our telephone number and here is our email address. Thank you.
Okay. Let me see. All right. Stop sharing. Did it stop?
Yes.
Okay. Before we move on, I want to give our audience a chance to ask Ms. Randles a couple questions that may have come across your mind as you heard about this incredible project. So with that, I would like to ask assistance from my very able folks working here to open the mic for any of our participants who may have a question for Ms. Randles. Are there any questions out there?
And you can also put the questions, if you weren't able to unmute your mic, you should be able to add questions into the chat or in the questions box.
Any questions? If not, I have a couple quick ones I would like to throw out. Ms. Randles, could you give the group an approximate understanding of how many students have come through who have successfully gone through your project over the time that you've been around?
Sure. This is our fifth year, and we've had over 100 students actually complete the 8-month program. We've had students. Actually, some of them first-time graduate high school in their families. We have students now are in college, you know, as a result of being a part of this program. We have kids now, they're working, you know, fast food like Taco Bell, McDonald's, and strongly because they have listed this program, you know, as a leadership opportunity. And so we've had some great success in the program.
Very good. And as we wrap up here, you've intimated through your presentation the incredible variety of uses of the sweet potatoes that they've grown. Perhaps you could close out your presentation and give us a list of some of those projects that they pitched during their Shark Tank experience over at FSU.
Right. I would say probably one of my favorite ones, the kids actually came up with the jingle, you know, and it's really allowing the kids to kind of use their natural talents, you know, and so some of the kids came up with a jingle. And I think probably one of my favorite recipes was a sweet potato muffin. We get orders today for our sweet potato muffin. In the summertime, we have the sweet shake. That's available that we go to health fairs and different events, and we actually sell our sweet shake at those types of events. I would say the sweet potato scroll is another tasty item. It's just been really amazing. This year, the kids were really creative. They came up with a sweet potato shampoo and conditioner, a sweet potato body rub. I mean, it's been so creative in just turning this sweet potato into all of these different, you know, types of products. Okay. One day we will see them, you know, on the market in the store.
There you go.
More question in the chat. Do you see this project, or do you see this as a project that could be expanded to other parts of the state? And what barriers have you faced in expanding?
Yeah, I would see definitely, you know, having a connection with the university, like with Fresno State. I mean, we had Dr. Castro, who was the previous president, was a strong supporter, and the ag department. So basically, we're sort of creating like this pathway for these kids at a junior high school level to, you know, kind of get into the ag career. And so by them going to Fresno State, by them going to and meeting those professors, like we sort of opened that door for them. So there's universities everywhere, right? And so just making that connection with that, with the president or the ag department, with that nonprofit agency, community-based organization, and other, you know, you have NRCS, USDA, they're everywhere. You know, CDFA, you guys are everywhere. So it's just a matter of making those connections. Barriers, it's always funding, right? You know, you need staff. You need to have the right staff making the right connection with those hard to reach youth in the community, right? And so making that connection, you know, is real important. But you guys are a CDFS and folks are on the line. You all can make those things happen.
All right. You know, please understand that it is the combination of the dedication and the time of the local leadership. You and Mr. Hamilton and other folks in the community are key, are instrumental in making the connections that have to happen between the local youth and their parents, as well as with the outside resources that are needed to support it. So in answer to your question, I would say it is bringing together both of those forces that allow this type of opportunity to thrive. So thank you, Ms. Randles. And for the sake of the program, you know, how does this fit with soils? You know, it fits very well with soils in my mind, because soil is something that these students never considered as something other than the stuff they brush off their shoes, and to actually see the magic that soils can produce once that seed is planted and is supported and nourished, you know, brings about whole new realities that they never even imagined. So it is with that we felt that it was so appropriate that we begin our Healthy Soils webinar this afternoon with talking about folks who just discovered soils, you know, much less the expertise that is going to be represented by those who follow. So I just wanted to make that link so folks could understand how it is that we wanted to include this presentation as part of our webinar today. So with that, Ms. Randles, you are invited to stay on, but if for understand you have a number of moving parts going on in your life today. So thank you so very much for spending time with us this morning.
Great. Thank you all so much. And please feel free to visit our website. There's some additional videos and additional information about the Sweet Potato Project there. And thank you so much for your time. And whoever asked that question about expanding, give me a call. I would love to sit down and talk with you and just share, you know, some of the lessons that we have learned, you know, over the years. Great. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. All right. Thank you again for your patience with our process this morning. And it is then my privilege to move on and give a little introduction to our next speaker. Becca Walls, I hope, please, am I pronouncing the last name correctly?
Yes? That's right,
Riles. All right. Is currently assistant professor of agroecology at the University of California, Merced. Her research program focuses on ecosystem-based climate solutions, particularly in agriculture, including the quantification of carbon storage and greenhouse gas emissions. I was personally very fascinated with a project that you have going on there in Merced and looking at working on orchards. I have worked with the Resource Conservation District out of that county, and I know that they are very vested in the work that you're doing. So with that, please, I'd like to welcome you to this webinar and look forward to what you will share today. Thanks.
Thank you so much. And you have my slides, right? So I just let you know when I'll advance. Okay, well, yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Nance, for the invitation and for moderating today. And I don't know if she's still on, but thanks to Yolanda. That was an awesome presentation, and it's so amazing to see programs that really inspire children to understand, appreciate, and love their natural resources and getting their hands dirty and growing food, healthy food for themselves. So wonderful project. So in the few minutes I have, I want to give a little bit of a primer about the science behind carbon sequestration in our working lands across the state, talk a little bit about why it's such an essential climate solution and give a case study for one example that's been going on for about 12 years now, which is compost addition to grazed grasslands. The orchard project, we just got started, so we don't have data to show there, but members of my lab work on rangelands, on croplands, on orchard systems, of a diverse amount of lands that we have here in California. And we work on a variety of soil health practices, including things like compost application. So next slide, please. So just a bit of basic information if you're not familiar with the science behind carbon sequestration. Soils are a really important reservoir of carbon on in our Earth system. They store more carbon than the atmosphere and all of the Earth's vegetation combined. It's an amazing pool of carbon that helps to regulate the climate at the global scale. And it's a dynamic ecosystem in the soil, so carbon moves in and out of the soil system, and so how we manage our soils has a huge impact on the amount of carbon that's stored there at a given time. And unfortunately, the bad news is that we've actually lost a lot of carbon from our soils across the world because of intensive or poor management of our soils, including in agricultural systems. So the benefit of that is that this is a huge opportunity to restore the carbon that are in, that has been lost from soils, and to help regulate the Earth's climate in at a global scale. Next slide, please. So when we're thinking about addressing climate change, this urgent challenge, there's no one solution that's going to solve it. It's a suite of actions that we need to take. We definitely need to reduce our fossil fuel emissions to get us lower from our business as usual growth curve in terms of atmospheric greenhouse gas emissions and the effects on temperature and climate change impacts. Reducing our fossil fuel emissions is an important part of the climate solution, but it's really just slowing down the rate of change in the atmosphere. And so the important role that soil plays in this part of the climate solution is as a drawdown solution. Increasing or managing ecosystems for carbon storage pulls carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere through photosynthesis, basically leverages the natural processes that are occurring in our ecosystem and puts carbon back into the soil. Next slide, please. In addition to helping regulate the Earth's climate, managing carbon for soil promotes so many really important services that soils provide. It is a key component of soil health, and it has many co-benefits that relate to the biological, physical, and chemical functions of the soil. Some things that are really important here in California agricultural systems especially are things like improving nutrient recycling so that we can reduce nutrient pollution, and also increasing water retention in the soils. Next slide, please. And so I'm going to present just one case study, one example of an effective carbon farming practice, which is compost application to grazed grasslands. So how does compost contribute to carbon sequestration? Well, if you know something about compost is made from organic material. Organic material has a lot of carbon in it. So you might just say, oh, we're just moving carbon from one place to another. That's not really the whole picture of carbon sequestration. It's true that those compost amendments have carbon in them, but like I said, soil is a dynamic ecosystem. So that carbon from the compost is not just sitting there, it's feeding the microbes in the soil, which are feeding the plants, and it's really boosting the function of that ecosystem. Next slide. And so it's really these indirect changes. Oh, sorry, if you could go back one, it's a very similar slide. It's really these indirect changes to ecosystem function that affects carbon storage. So that compost is going to affect the rate of photosynthesis, basically how much plants can grow, how much CO2 they can draw out of the atmosphere. It's going to affect root growth and stimulate microbial activity and the ability of soil structure and physical properties to improve to hold that carbon in there in a better way. So when we're doing the science behind carbon storage, we're really trying to understand all of these complex interactions in the soil, plant, atmosphere, and water systems to really quantify what's happening. Next slide, please. So the example that I'll show here is through a project called the Marin Carbon Project, which started in 2018. For this project, we added a one-time application, about a half an inch application of compost to the surface of grazed grasslands in a valley grassland in the Sierra Foothill and then a coastal grassland in the Marin Headlands. We sampled soils. We also sampled a whole bunch of other things because we're interested in potential other benefits or trade-offs of this practice. I'm only going to show a glimpse of the many pieces of data that we collected. And I should also note that this is a long-term study, but it's now been replicated at 17 sites through the Marin Carbon Project and has been implemented all over the state through implementation and demonstration projects that are funded through the Healthy Soils Program as well. Next slide, please. So just a snippet of findings from this study. These data show biomass carbon, which is basically the amount of forage that's produced in these grazed systems over the time span of this study, about 10 years worth of data showing here. The blue is the control areas where no compost was added. The red are the areas where compost was added. And we saw an immediate and sustained increase in plant production. That increase is muted when there's drought years, so there's a lot of interactions between water and carbon. But even in 2018, where we still had a pretty significant drought, we do see increases in that forage production. Next slide, please. And that increase in forage production, it contributes to those indirect fluxes of carbon back into that soil system. And so over time, in addition to that sustained increase in plant production, we see more carbon being stored in that soil. So this figure shows a change in carbon stock. So this is the difference between the compost and the control areas. So basically anything above the line means that compost addition was effective at increasing carbon storage. Anything below that line would show a carbon loss. And after the application of compost, we see sustained increases in carbon storage in the top 30 centimeters of that soil. That rate happens at about 8.8 megagrams of carbon per hectare over 10 years. Next slide, please. And we also find that new carbon is being stored in physically protected pools. This is a good indication that it's likely to stay there for a long time, be protected and feed back into that soil system. Next slide, please. In addition to looking at the ecosystem benefits of carbon storage, we also try to understand the life cycle impacts on greenhouse gas emissions. So we've done a lot of work on quantifying life cycle emissions that include both the ecosystem impact, but also things like transportation, the management of those compost piles, any avoided emissions that come from alternative fates. And we see huge potentials. And when we scale this up and we consider those life cycle applications, even if we apply this to only 5% of our rangelands, this is equivalent to offsetting all of the emissions from the livestock sector of the state or all of the emissions from household energy use across the state. So these are scalable, large, potential reservoirs of carbon that are feasible in some areas of the state. Next slide, please. And as I mentioned, this study is being replicated at many places and demonstrated through this Healthy Soils Program. Literature also summarizes information across many sites, not just in California. And we see pretty significant findings that are replicated over large spaces. So the studies that are undergoing right now are showing similar rates of carbon sequestration. This really great meta-analysis that came out a couple of years ago, where they had over 200 studies that were included in this analysis, showed increases in soil carbon were remarkably consistent across the literature. So this is a practice that we feel pretty confident about in terms of its application to soil carbon sequestration. Next slide, please. And then just one picture slide to show some of the work that we're doing. There's always more questions than that we can pursue. And so one question that I'm really interested in that has implications for who has access to technical assistance and funding to incentivize compost application is looking at the application of these compost piles on steep slopes. Right now through the Healthy Soils Program and through the Natural Resource Conservation Service's conservation practice standard for compost amendments, there's a restriction on the application based on slope with the idea that the nutrients will run off and become a water quality concern. We don't think that's happening, and so we are right now studying this in the Altamont Pass in Livermore, where we have very steep slopes. This color map up here shows different levels of steepness, and right now it's really only the dark green areas that would be eligible for incentives or financial assistance for compost application. So you can see most of the area would be excluded from financial incentives. But again, we're not really seeing those different, that trade-off and runoff. So this is an important area that we're trying to understand and refine our decision-making process for where compost is effective as a carbon strategy without having consequences. And then last slide. Last slide is just a summary here to say that I hope this is an example that managing our soils for carbon storage is an important carbon climate solution. And there's many different soil health practices that can help to increase soil carbon. And what we found with compost application to grazed lands, this is an example of a replicable, viable, and scalable strategy for soil carbon sequestration that has benefits like increasing water retention. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, ma'am. Appreciate your time this morning. Regrettably, we're having some technical issues that will keep us from being able to show this, I think. Are we going to be able to show the...
No, unfortunately, we won't be able to show this video because of my technical difficulties. This is Arma. I'm so sorry about that. But we will be sending it out to all attendees after the fact, including the videos from the Sweet Potato Project, and you'll see there's another video later. So we'll send those out to all attendees. They'll be made available after this.
Excellent. Thank you, ma'am. I appreciate the clarification. Dr. Riles, in lieu of not being able to show it, could you talk a little bit about the Marin Project and how it led to this family taking on the application there in Yolo, and I guess it was two other counties. They were in three counties. It's a pretty impressive video. So Marin Carbon Project as the kickoff. But I think that I really want to encourage folks attending to go to YouTube if you cannot get the link to work. But it's an impressive endeavor. Please, could you share a little bit about it?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I think farmers are scientists themselves. They're always testing out what works. They're always thinking they have the most knowledge about what's happening on their land. And so the Marin Carbon Project really started because ranchers in Marin County knew something about the importance of soils. They also wanted to restore native grasses. And this is John Wick and Peggy Rathman were the farmers that we worked with. And they thought, you know, cows were bad, kick the cows off of the land. When they did that, they actually saw a shift in the plant communities in worse ways, more invasive species. And so they kind of realized the importance of grazing in that grassland system, but also wanted to kind of jumpstart the system and really increase carbon storage as a climate solution. And so when the ranchers actually approached my PhD advisor, Wendy Silver, where I was doing grad school at UC Berkeley, and we thought this was going to be a simple answer. You know, they came to us and said, how can we put more carbon in our soils? And so we said, let's go through the literature. And we really found that there was a dearth of information about what we can do, especially local. I mean, context matters. So what works in California might not work in another place and vice versa. And so there was really a need to do these local studies and to generate some knowledge about our own lands in California and what could be done. We started with an extensive survey across rangelands in Marin and Sonoma County. And we found a wide range in the amount of carbon that was at a given place. And one thing that really stuck out was areas that had received organic amendments, whether it was compost or manure application, they had a lot more soil carbon than those that hadn't. That's pretty intuitive, but again, we needed to measure all of the ins and outs and the rates over time. And so we knew that applying organic matter amendments seemed to be one good way to do that. And so that really necessitated these field trials, which I'm the data that I've shown here for those long-term trials. And so this was successful both in terms of increasing forage production. That's really important for the ranchers in our state, especially when we have really dry years, to having practices that a one time can have multi-year effects is really important. And it had increased water retention in the soil as well. And it didn't increase the invasion of noxious weeds, which was a concern that we monitored as well. And so the ranchers that we worked with, John and Peggy, but also all of the ranchers, about a dozen or so in that first survey, were all really excited about these results. And, more and more people wanted to test it out. It actually started more people composting on site with the manure or food scraps or whatever resources they had to generate kind of on-farm recycling as well. And so the farm in Yolo is another great example of that. Just seeing your neighbors, success of one farmer is probably the scientific papers are great. That's what we do in my lab. Like, we hope to publish these papers, but really that knowledge and that experience from the farmers and the stories that they can tell about the experience with any given practice is one way to help motivate other farmers to think about practices that they can do. So the Yolo, that is a great video. And that's just another example of farmers that saw that successful in one place, tried it out themselves, it worked, they continued on with it, and they're seeing good results so far.
They really are. And the thing that impressed me about the video was the way they talked about leveraging resources, about taking advantage of CDFA money, about working with other private entities, and using all of that in order to bring to bear the type of change that they want to see over the long term on their 15,000 plus acres. So again, thank you very much for your work in jumpstarting this effort with the Marin County project and with all the work that you're doing at Merced. Thank you, ma'am. Appreciate it. And invite, and please, if you can stick around in order to respond to questions, we'd appreciate it. But for the time being, we're gonna keep moving, if you don't mind.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right. It is, I now have the opportunity of inviting to join us today is Karen Lowell. Karen, I love your little space there. I wish I could jump in and have it as well. Karen works with the Natural Resources Conservation Service, an agency that I have a mild familiarity with. She has been with the agency now for going on what will be 10 years coming this spring. You could see from her right up here before you that she is involved in, I know she's got, I hope that she will speak a little bit about the Marin County project, because I have to believe that your fingerprints are all over that. Karen's work is beyond amazing in that area and is appreciated both by partners and by her colleagues within the organization. It is an effort on the part of California NRCS to keep the national hands off of her because they keep wanting to drag her away from giving us her full time and attention. But so far, you know, by virtue of the fact that she's even with us today, we've been mildly successful in that. So with that, I'm going to stop and turn the mic over to Karen. Welcome, Karen. Glad you could join us today. Karen, I think you're frozen. Can you? It says that you are self-muted. Now it says that you are offline.
We can go to, while Karen sorts out her connectivity issues, we can go to Dr. Bowles' presentation if you're okay with that, Dr. Bowles.
Yeah, that should be fine. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, we can. Thank you, sir. So with that, appreciate your flexibility. Dr. Bowles is going to discuss today soil health impact on water filtration and drought resilience. He currently is the assistant professor of agroecology and sustainable agricultural systems in the Department of Environmental Science, Policy, and Management at UC Berkeley. He is the co-director of the Berkeley Food Institute and conducts research on carbon, nitrogen, water dynamics, and the plant microbe interactions in agricultural systems. Dr. Bowles is expertise in the practical applications of this research is a very important link in our process that we're discussing today. So with that, let me turn it over to Dr. Bowles. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. I apologize. I just can't seem to get my camera to work. And promise I'm very handsome and you'd love to see me, but sorry, I just have my voice here. So some of this, I hope Karen can kind of fill in some of the gaps here. But what I really want to talk about today is really how some of the big picture about how healthy soils can help us adapt to drought and ultimately save irrigation water, right? I mean, part of adapting to drought is facing the reality that you know, the water that we'll have available either through surface water or through groundwater is just going to become more limiting in the future. So starting off here, if we could play the video, I know it won't play, but on the right-hand side, there's, oh, maybe it will. Oh, wonderful. So this is a video from a small farm up in Sonoma County that they took during the atmospheric river event that we had a few weeks ago, right? When we were so fortunate that it dumped all this rain. And they got 13 inches of rain over 2 days. And what you see on the right-hand side there is all of these, after all this rain, all of these bubbles bubbling up from soil as all of this water infiltrates into their soil, right? After being dry for so long. And this is a farm that has really worked intensively on building soil health. And they might be, kind of an extreme case of possibilities, but it does define at least some of the horizon in which we might be able to work towards, right? The picture on the left is, a picture over 24 hours of the water that they received. And you can see just this tremendous amount of water that had flowed on and then infiltrated over a short period of time, right? This is really incredible. So this is the type of thing we need to work towards. Okay, so you can go to the next slide. So what I want to talk about is just kind of some of the research frontiers that we have in terms of being able to link building soil health with saving irrigation water. And I want to frame this broadly. Even in normal years, we get most of our rain and snow in a handful of atmospheric river events, like what we found a few weeks ago, like what we had a few weeks ago, right? Maybe four or five of these in a good year, two or three in a bad year. these are big rain events, dump a lot of rain in a relatively short amount of time. So we have to be able to both take advantage of those while also reducing irrigation water that's applied during lean times. So the question here is, how can healthy soils help? How can we both think about our water management and soil health together? Right, next slide, please. So first is that healthy soil can help us enable reducing irrigation. So there's a couple of water management strategies that are being talked about a lot that could help save a lot of water. One is delaying the onset of irrigation, either in the spring after our rains have ended or in between irrigations until we use up as much of the water that's in soil as possible. We could also think about applying fewer larger irrigations rather than many small ones like we often do with our drip or micro sprinkler systems. Go to the next slide. And there's been some really interesting modeling. Oh, one back, please. There's been some really interesting modeling that shows that when we do these types of irrigation schemes, when we use more soil water, when we reduce the frequency of irrigation but irrigate more, we save a tremendous amount of water. So this study showed that we can save about 30 cubic kilometers of irrigation water by reducing evaporation and increasing soil water use over a 13-year period. So that type of saving from these water management strategies could fill Lake Shasta 6.5 times over that 13-year period. So just keep this in mind when we have conversations about, oh, do we need more reservoir capacity? Right? There's a lot with our water management strategies that we can do to save water, and healthy soils can help. Because we know that when we have healthy soils, we increase infiltration. When we're growing cover crops and we keep the soil covered, we increase infiltration. We get more of that rainwater into soil, which then allows us to do things like delay the onset of irrigation. So we can go to the next slide, please. So just as one example of this, one technique that is growing in terms of interest is whole orchard recycling. This is when you're turning over an orchard, instead of cutting those trees and removing them, you actually grind them up and apply all that ground up mulch to soil. And it can have very long lasting impacts. So this little graph on the right here, just basically what it's showing is the increase in soil moisture content when we have the ground biomass. That's with whole orchard recycling. That's the blue line far on the right compared to burning that biomass. Now, and we can also compare this under deficit irrigation. And what we see is that when we grind up this biomass, we get higher soil moisture, even with deficit irrigation, compared to when we burn that biomass. So this is tried and true strategy for increasing soil water content and allowing for reduction in irrigation. Next slide, please. Another way that soil health practices can help is by reducing evaporation. There's been great work by a number of folks, Jeff Mitchell's group working down near Fresno, looking how, for instance, retaining crop residues on the soil surface can dramatically reduce summer evaporative losses and help make these fewer, larger irrigations work in terms of saving water. So we can go to the next slide. Another water management strategy is reducing the stress that crops can feel when we reduce water inputs. So these types of deficit irrigation strategies, that is applying less irrigation water than standard, can create stress for crops. Of course, if you're a grower, you don't want that. You don't want your yields to suffer. But if we can have healthy soil management, we can often reduce these negative impacts on crop production via changes to soil, for instance, by promoting healthier soil microbial communities. You go to the next slide. Some of the research that we've done in the past is looking at just one really cool group of soil microorganisms. They're these soil fungi that form associations with plant roots. And when we found in the presence of these these microbial symbionts, these microbial organisms, we can reduce irrigation water, but have 25% higher tomato yields compared to when we don't have these microorganisms present. And many of the practices that we focus on for healthy soils, things like reducing disturbance and growing cover crops, are the types of things that help promote these types of important soil organisms. All right, and now the last slide is really about how do we capture the rainwater during these intense atmospheric river events in ways that don't require us to build more reservoir capacity. And so there's been a lot of interest in groundwater recharge, that is using flood waters to recharge groundwater and looking at different types of systems where this can work. Healthy soil management can help this work better, and this is an active area of research. For instance, one potential negative impact of groundwater recharge is actually flushing nitrate and other soil contaminants that we're concerned about for water quality down into groundwater. But if we're growing cover crops, we're preventing that nitrate from getting into that groundwater because that cover crop is taking up that nitrate. It's not allowing it to percolate down into groundwater. Other soil health practices also help maintain soil structure that helps this groundwater recharge actually happen. So there's a number of ways that we can think about how, just to sum up, how our water management strategies that go into saving irrigation water, taking advantage of these big atmospheric river events can interact with healthy soil management in ways that help us adapt. So we have a lot of work to do to really make these actionable for growers, but there are innovative growers out there who are already doing this. And so we need both to be learning from them and doing the research to document exactly when, where, and how this works. So thanks for listening, and hopefully Karen can share a little bit more now.
Thank you very much, sir. I appreciate your time and appreciate your expertise here. We have, it appears that Dr. Lowell is having some connectivity issues, and as a result, quite regrettably, we're not going to be able to have her expertise here to fill in the gaps, given her work with NRCS. She is working with farmers and ranchers every day in the application of this, and her unique contribution in this area is that she not only has the expertise on the research side, but also has an understanding of how to translate this to the growers and to the individuals who work. Karen, are you there?
I am here. Can you hear me?
Oh,
we can. Let's. I know they'd much rather hear from you than me. So, given the fact that I've already done your introduction, the floor is yours, ma'am.
Thank you, and I apologize. USDA computers have a firewall in it. Every now and then, I think some gremlins get into it, so my apologies. I'm going to leave my camera off with hopes that bandwidth will remain a little bit more reliable. So thank you very much, and I will carry on trying to, our order was meant to be reversed, but this is beautiful because now I can move a little quickly through things that Tim has addressed for us. Can we go to the next slide, Sharon? Somehow we went backwards. There we go. So as Sharon said, I work with USDA and NRCS, and we like to say that we were all about soil health before soil health was cool. Our mission really started in the 1930s, really focused on maintaining our soils as the essential anchor for our land-based ecosystems. And all those functions that you've heard Becca and Tim discuss, those are really our bread and butter. We want to keep the soil in place and keep it doing what it needs to do to support all life on Earth, really. So we want to keep it in place. We want to protect it. We want to keep the good parts working well, keep carbon in the soil, keep the nutrients where we need and want them. and avoid bad things building up. In California, salt accumulation in our arid climate is a major consideration. So NRCS is all about trying to make sure the soil continues to work for us. And sort of the master key for many of those functions of the soil is keeping the life in the soil, and carbon, as we, our life as we know it on Earth, is built on carbon. So maintaining carbon in the soil is sort of our master key in a lot of the work that we do as we think about soil health. Next slide, please, Sharon. So let's talk about carbon. You've heard some really exciting things, and I'm all in. Sign me up for the carbon enthusiasm. I also look growers and ranchers in the eye many, many days, and I want to kind of insert a little bit of a reality check for us here and remind ourselves that carbon is a cycle. Carbon cycles. It doesn't just, one of my research colleagues said, said carbon, there's not a one-way highway for carbon into the soil. What we want, and many of the core benefits we get from putting carbon into our soils, come from the fact that it is cycling through living life forms. So a reality check, potential organic carbon, that's the OC there that you see in that little graphic. There's potential that is largely driven by what are the soils that we're trying to maintain and accumulate carbon in. Then there's what's attainable, and a lot of that is driven by climate factors. So rainfall, temperature, solar radiation, those are critical, and they have an impact on what's realistic for us in a given system. And then of course there's management. And that's where my agency and CDFA's efforts and Becca's efforts and Tim's research, we're all focused on how do we hit the sweet spot? How do we help guide management, support management, incentivize management that will optimize the potentials that we have given the realities of our soils and our climate factors. And as Tim has alluded, climate and weather are changing. And we have, for example, less frequent, more intense storms. That leads to those huge rainfall events that Tim showed you what the impact of that is. How do we get that water in the ground where we want it and not running off or evaporating from the surface? So next slide, Sharon. So my agency really, and CDFA's efforts and other efforts around the state, really work with producers to help them think about what can you do? What's movable? What are the movable parts that we can influence? And so ARMA asked me to think particularly in light of Secretary Ross's real emphasis on thinking about, you know, we got drought and we need to help our producers deal with those hard realities. So those practices you see listed on the right-hand side are some of the things that Healthy Soils Program and CDFA and NRCS incentivize as practices we believe will have a positive impact on carbon management, healthy soil functions. And we have real interest. Two of them that are very popular for the CDFA programs as well as ours are adding carbon amendments in work like Becca described, and then also cover cropping. And cover cropping is a real workhorse. I often joke if I could keep one practice, it might be cover cropping. It's tricky. It's tricky in our climate conditions and our cropping systems. I'm not even going to touch on the cropping system complexities. I'm just going to touch on some of the issues associated with water and cover crops. So next slide. So y'all have seen the hydrologic cycle somewhere along the way in your education. In the cover crop discussion with regard to water, cover crops do really good things. Tim showed you, I kind of glad I followed you, Tim. He showed you a great illustration of how water going into the soil can be critically important, right? If you have one of those big rain events and you're not taking that water in, you're either going to evaporate it off the soil or you're going to lose it as runoff. We don't want that to happen. We drop God sees fit to give us to go into the soil. And we want that water that's in the soil to be available to plants. It's a longer discussion than we have time for today, but bottom line, soils hold on to water. There are physical forces that hold the water that enters the soil to the soil separate particles in the soil matrix. And we want our crops to be able to get at the water that we have in the soil, and organic matter helps with that. So that's one of the reasons we want to maximize what we have by way of soil organic carbon. And as noted, the, you know, we want to maximize getting the water in, minimize losing the water by either, but it's tricky. Cover crops also use water. And in a state that has just been told through the Central Valley not to count on water deliveries next year, anything that isn't sellable that uses water is going to get a skeptical eyebrow raised. So that's the conversation we need to be prepared to have with our growers. Next slide, Karen. There's a little lag. There we go. So conservation or cover cropping in California meets reality. This is a kind of an interesting slide from some work one of my colleagues did, looking at when you plant cover crops, how do we manage them in a way that we maximize the benefits, minimize the drawbacks. Benefits, we maximize water capture. Drawback, we use some water. So what you're looking at here, that line heading up and to the right, is showing the soil getting drier. As the line goes up, the soil is getting drier. So in the green line going up, that's a cover crop drawing down the moisture in the top 5 inches of the soil. That's not desirable. What we want is to get that water in and have it there for the crop that's going to follow. So one way we can manage that is to think about how we manage the cover crop. Next slide, Karen.
Sorry for the lag.
Are we doing it?
Can we get there? There we go.
There we go. Okay. So this is just sort of a food for thought thing to offer our growers a nod. We know they are innovative. We know, as Becca said, they are scientists as well. And we take our lead working closely with our extension partners, our research partners, research scientists to say, okay, we know that the cover crops will help us. We also know that we don't want them to be using up water. How much do we need to let them grow in order to see those benefits that are illustrated in this graph? And let me explain it real quick. So on the right-hand side, that big tall bar B is showing you what happens when rainfall hits bare ground. Almost half of the rainfall that hits that ground is going to run off. We don't want to see that, right? We want to see what's happening in that nice pink A. Less than 2.5% of the rainfall that hit the ground ran off. How much cover crop do we need to accomplish that? That's the real exciting part. If you look at the pictures in the bottom of that slide, it doesn't take much. The living root is a conduit to connect the surface of the soil to deeper in the profile where that water is protected and able to be stored. So this is an example of some work in the Central Coast where the issue is also schedule of operations. Market is tough in California, and they need to get their crops in the ground when they need to get them in the ground. So they'll often list up ground and leave it ready for planting early. So that's a challenge, right? Because then it's bare in the winter rain. So this was work that was done to illustrate, hey, even if you kill it and it looks like virtually nothing, you will have an incredible benefit to capturing water in your soil and avoiding that runoff with also, I would note, water quality benefits, right? Because water running off carries sediment, and that's many of our streams are 303 delisted. We want to keep the soil on the land, not in the water. So this is sort of creative thinking and capturing benefits for California reality. Next slide, Sharon. And I just, while I'm waiting for that to shift, I really want to hit hard on the point that, you know, we talk about building soil carbon. I'm all for it. If we can do it, fantastic. It's also a really worthwhile goal that has considerable benefits to the resilience of our farming systems to maintain carbon. Even if we don't significantly bump it up, we're not going to see likely, you know, 5-6% soil organic matter in our systems like you might in the upper Midwest. But even if we are able, and many of our growers talk about this, there's a grower here on the coast who tells me, I don't grow the crops, I grow the soil. The soil grows the crops. He writes into his leases that his lessees must apply compost. He recognizes that these intensively tilled systems, it's going to be hard to build carbon. So he writes into that plan that they must maintain carbon. And that has considerable benefit in his systems. So this last slide that I'm going to end on is just to point out, this ain't new, folks, right? This is research publication from 1994. We know we can manage these systems, and growers have been doing it. A lot of the vineyards, they've talked to me about it for years. They know that by carefully timing when they mow, when they terminate the cover crop, they can manage the water uptake cost of including cover crop in the system. So we can help maximize that, and by being open-minded and flexible and California specific as we support our producers in adopting some of these practices, we can help them maximize benefits and minimize drawbacks. And my money's on California farmers and ranchers to figure it out. As Becca said, they lead, and they will help us know when we're wandering off into crazy town, and they'll guide us to fix it and get it right. So thank you very much for the opportunity to speak to you, and I'm happy to stick around for whatever time is left.
Excellent. Thank you, ma'am. Appreciate you. I want to defer to my helper bee there to see if we have received any questions in the chat. If not, we have some other questions pre-planned that we would be happy to. I would be happy to direct to our presenters. Anything?
We do have questions, and we have a hand up. So I'm going to defer first to our attendee with a hand up. And I apologize if I pronounced your name incorrectly, Duprea Sanders. If you wouldn't mind unmuting yourself. Sorry, I'm trying to give everyone control over their own audio, and it says that you have it, but I'm not sure that you do. All right, if not, I can.
What about answer now? The question. People, I just tried on my end. Yeah, it's so weird. It looks like we can click it and it says attendees will have full audio control and may unmute themselves. Yeah, and then it's not doing anything.
Okay, well, let me instead pop out the questions and I can ask those. So if you want to ask questions, please feel free to put them in the questions box. I know that we have one about compost specifically from Becca from your presentation. And basically, the question that we had was, is California producing enough compost to scale up? And if not, what can the state do to help increase production?
Yeah, that's a great question. And so a couple of things. One is there's always more of demand for compost than we can deliver. Farmers and ranchers know that this is a really valuable resource. And so it's used very well. There are a few things that the state is already doing, which is very exciting, and we'll see how it plays out. But there's a relatively new law called SB 1383, which is basically it requires diversion of organic waste streams from landfills by 2025, I believe. So like a 75% diversion of organic waste from landfills. That's going to be massive. If that material is not going to landfills, then it has to go be used in a beneficial way somewhere else. And so that might incentivize new composting facilities or just a, you know, better capture of that material and so that it's not wasted. I do have a paper from my lab that we did a geospatial model of if we were able to achieve that goal, you know, what's the connectivity between our urban areas and our rural areas where it could be most used. And there's high potential. I can't remember the number off the top of my head, but basically the capturing of those resources can cover a lot of our agricultural landscapes. The nice thing about compost too, is that it provides benefits for multiple years. So, I mean, depending on your system, it's always about context for what's needed from that particular system, rangeland versus cropland. might need different application rates and timing and frequency. But what we saw with our work with the Marine Carbon Project, all of that results that we see even 10, 12 years later is from a one-time application in 2008. So that compost is really, you know, as Karen was describing, it's really feeding back to that soil system and providing all of those biological, physical, and chemical functions for the soil. So it's really kind of kickstarting that system in a new way. So we produce a lot of compost in the state. We could produce more by better capturing our organic waste streams, and that SB 1383 might incentivize that. I forgot my last point. Yeah, I mean, there's a high demand for it, and I think we another thing is also compost is, it can be expensive. So things like the Healthy Soils Program that for the implementation part of it, that provides funding to help subsidize the cost of compost, is going to help more farmers have access to compost resources.
Thank you, ma'am. In lieu of having our presenters comment on this question, I want to try to introduce a new topic. Let me check once more to see if we've either been able to engage our hand raiser or if we have another question in the chat before I go to our other.
Go for it.
Okay, excellent. We have just a very few minutes, and one of the things that I would like to hear from each of our three presenters comment briefly on is, how does soil health impact communities adjacent to ag lands? You know, we've been talking about ag systems, but the reality is that we have communities that are bumping up against these ag lands, and we've already said multiple times our challenge is going to be water. So please, if we could hear from our three presenters, I'd like to start with Tim, please.
Sure, thanks. It's such an important question. I mean, a couple of ways come to mind. One is with water quality. A million Californians lack access to clean drinking water, right? And the majority of those, it's because of nitrate contamination of groundwater. And this is an environmental justice problem. Communities, particularly marginalized communities, often communities of farm workers who can't afford to drill deeper drinking water wells. We know that soil health practices like winter cover cropping are the best way to reduce nitrate leaching alongside good irrigation management.
Okay.
So, you know, that to me is front and center. And I could go on, but I'll let Karen and Becca weigh in as well.
Okay, excellent. Karen, please.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I'm going to talk really fast because there are a lot of ways. Tim touched water quality. I will touch water quantity. Not only do we need clean water, we need water. We need water down. Many of our communities rely on groundwater as a drinking water source. Air quality is huge. If you keep the soil covered and in place, not impacting air quality, which has huge health implications, particularly in some of our Central Valley communities. Also, example, Crop Baby, my pet practice. If you keep the ground covered in a dense cover cropping system, for example, you can smother weeds. If you smother weeds, you can reduce your reliance on pesticides to control weed pressure in your cropping systems. Likewise, a well-planned soil health management system and cover crop, including cover crop. Again, I love them. May help reduce some of the pest pressures, soil-borne disease and pest pressures in your cropping systems, both of which will again reduce your pesticide reliance. So I'm not going to say you get rid of your pesticides. I'm going to say it helps build a robust robust IPM program built on our fantastic UCIPM resources. Tag, you're it, Becca.
Yes, ma'am. Becca, please take us home.
Yeah, wonderful. I agree with all of those really nice summary of so many important things. And I'll just, you know, re-emphasize air quality. I'm here in the Central Valley. I have a young child. I'm very concerned about our really poor air quality here. And the way we manage our soils affects dust, so the particulate matters that go into the atmosphere, NOx emissions from the soil, ammonia emissions, things that we can smell, odors that come from poorly managed waste streams. This is something that I didn't appreciate really until living in the Central Valley, but it's a major concern for our socially disadvantaged communities here in the Central Valley in particular. And then echo to all of the lists of other important benefits that Karen and Tim mentioned as well.
You know, thank you very much. And what I appreciate by you, the responses to this question is, it's not an either or issue. We don't either focus on just ag, or do we focus on the communities that are everywhere in California of all different sizes. You know, progress is going to be made when we acknowledge the integration, the overlap, the need for both, for everyone to be supported by these critical efforts. Thank you for very, very practical applications on how healthy soils has this broad-based applications and implications. So, Karen,
I just want to say one more thing. Healthy soils support food production and reliance. You know, our economy is built on ag here in the state, and having a good, strong, resilient agricultural production sector is essential to keep people food, clothed, fed, clothed, and housed. It's essential. And to keep us going long term, we need to pay attention to how we're managing that keystone resource. It's the soil. You know, without good soil, it's awful hard to touch all those other boxes.
It is. And as I get ready to turn the close over to Rachel, I have to share one statistic that I just loved sharing with people during my time living in Fresno County. And that was that the ag value of what comes out of just Fresno and Tulare County is the cash equivalent to 22 other states in the country. I mean, if we're talking about just those two, and then we begin to add in the others, what happens in California has a major impact on ag food systems, not only in this country, but around the world. So with that, I want to thank you all very much for your participation and your patience with us this morning. This afternoon. And with that, thank you. And Rachel, it's yours.
Yeah, we did have one more question that came into the chat. Did we want to try and get to that, or are we going to follow up in writing, Irma? I know we're close to time.
I think we're going to follow up in writing just for time purposes, but rest assured that we will follow up.
Yeah, that's good. You can end it. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Yeah. Okay, great. It sounds like somebody needs to go on mute, maybe one of the presenters, but we'll follow up with that last question in writing. Wanted to give a huge thanks to all of our presenters, and especially to Dr. Sharon Nance, who moderated for us today. It was amazing. And thank you to our attendees for hanging in there with us with all of these kind of technical challenges. But I think content-wise, what a wealth of information you all have shared with us today, and really want to thank you on behalf of the Department of Food and Agriculture. So with that, we're going to close up, and just want to thank everybody for their time today.